Right is where we left off, you're going? Yeah, I think I just did this overview slide. I'll just move on to the pharynx. What I want to do is I want to take you through the respiratory tract. The respiratory tract is a dead end. You ventilate fresh air all the way to the alveolar spaces, but it starts with the nose. What we call the nose is the external nares, your nostrils with hair follicles. Breathe air through your nose. You can also breathe air through your mouth, but we don't teach the mouth as part of the airway, it's the food way. You only breathe through your mouth if you have to, if you're congested, and that's very uncomfortable. You don't want to do that, you dry out your mouth. But you're supposed to ventilate air through your nasal cavities, through after your external nares. The nasal cavities, with those conchae, there's three of them, superior, middle, inferior. Superior, middle, inferior conchae. They kind of break up the air and slow down the airflow and warm and humidify air. Slow down airflow. Warm. Humidify air. And I'll add on, you're starting to cleanse the air of impurities like dust particles. So your nose is your external nares. To go from nasal cavities to the throat, this area here is known as the internal nares. So all right, the internal nares leads to the throat or pharynx, which is divided into three parts, as you can see on this slide. Throat or pharynx. Divided into three parts. Naso, oral, laryngo, pharynx. Naso pharynx. Oral pharynx. Laryngopharynx. Now, if you look at an anatomically more accurate picture, like next slide, I got this one there. I'm going to zoom in on that picture on the right there. A couple things to point out here. This area is the nasopharynx, and it's posterior to the nasal cavities. Right? This little orifice right here leads to the auditory tube. The auditory tube is a canal that actually goes to the middle ear, the tympanic cavity. So your throat is connected to your ear via this orifice. The other thing to note here is a bit of lymphoid tissue. This is the pharyngeal tonsil. I'll note those two things. orifice to auditory tube. And the pharyngeal tonsil. The oropharynx is behind the oral cavity. You see the root of the tongue there, I'm gonna move the picture up there. And there's a lingual tonsil, lingual tonsil is here at the root of the tongue, and there's a little, this is called the fosses, the archways in your mouth. And in there is the palatine tonsil. Okay, so I don't know those two lingual tissues there. Lingual tonsil, palatine tonsil. It's all lymphoid tissue. So, palatine tonsil. I said it was in that little archway called the fosses. In fosses, F-A-U-C-E-S. And then the lingual tonsil on the root of the tongue. You know that one. Root of tongue. Now, when you get down to the laryngopharynx right here, it's basically a fork in the road. You can either go down the food tube, the esophagus, or since we're talking about breathing, you want to get to the airway, which is in here. That's the larynx. Leads to the esophagus slash, I'll call it the laryngeal inlet. That's how you get in the airway. Participate in an anatomy lab where paramedic students, they practice intubation. And what they have to do is, they have to intubate through the mouth. And they take I forget what that metal blade is called. And you have to you're standing behind the cadaver, face up, take your blade in, you lift the blade up. Okay. And you've got a metal blade in someone's mouth, you've got to be very careful. Has anyone ever intubated? Okay. You actually intubated?
Oh, actually
done it. You done it? No. Oh, okay. Yeah, if you've ever seen it done, they always teach the paramedics, you get that blade in there, you lift up to move the tongue out of the way. You're trying to get a clear view of right there. See those lips? Those are the vocal cords. You see the vocal cords? That's the glottis. That's the way to the trachea. You're trying to see that. And they always say, when you lift it up, don't tilt. Like when you say cheers to someone, cheers. You don't tilt your glass, you'll spill your drink, right? Because when you tilt it, you can damage the molars. And I remember one time I had a student who came and he said, yeah, when they intubated me, they cracked my molar. And they wouldn't even help her. It was all on her for her own pay for own dental work. So, that's the goal. And when I watch students do it, we have the whole thing open. You can see the lungs and we can see the stomach. So if they miss, they inflate the stomach and we can see that. And of course, they do it correctly, we can see them inflate the lungs. Okay, so that's a very important fork in the road. I want to learn how to do that. Okay, this picture here, let me kind of orient you. You can do a dissection, I've never done it, but you can remove the head from the spine. Let me show you about that so you can understand the next picture. Just cut these ligaments here of C1. And you're going to separate right along this line. And you're going to, so that way you separate head and throat from the cervical vertebra, the posterior neck. And then you cut the throat open and you get a nice view into all this. So that dissection is there. So there's no vertebra here. This is the throat cut open. So this is the pharynx, literally. There's the conchae, so that's the nasal cavity, right? There's the nasal septum right there. That's the root of the tongue, so that's the oral cavity. There's a laryngeal inlet. This is what the larynx looks like with, you know, the mucous membrane on it. Okay, so there you go, that's the airway. And this is the epiglottis. Every time you swallow food, this goes down, it guards the airway so you don't choke. Or something can slip past there, and you can choke. Well, let's just stick to the anatomy of the larynx. Now, usually what we present models in the classroom looks more like this, the laryngeal cartilages. This is what the larynx looks like if you remove the membrane, basically the skin covering it, okay? So, you know, I always like to put these side by side so you can kind of relate. Here's a picture, same idea, model in the room. So it's over there. There you go. Yeah. Identify. You know what you're looking at there? Tongue. Yeah, root of the tongue. There's laryngeal inlet. I like what they did with this model. Like, here's the skin on. Then all the blue stuff, that's hyaline cartilage. Skin on, skin off. Okay. So it's a good model to study the larynx with. Here's a side view of that model. Okay. We call it the tongue larynx model. So, now, here is how the larynx is positioned in the neck. I just kind of took this image and I gave it the same tilt as this picture that we studied for the common carotid artery. Okay, so you can kind of see how the larynx, trachea, is basically your anterior neck, and it's in front of the cervical vertebra, which form your posterior neck. Okay, this is your voice box, and this is a lecture on respiratory, but let's talk about all the laryngeal cartilages you're supposed to know. Well, that big laryngeal cartilage is the thyroid cartilage. That's a can't miss. It's your voice box. And when people say voice box, they're referring to that. Now, thyroid means shield. Shaped like a shield. Is all hyaline cartilage. And the thyroid, I guess the one surface feature I would have you know is this tip right there. That's the laryngeal prominence. The Adam's apple in a male. It's more prominent in males. More prominent in males. Males typically have a deeper voice because I think our thyroid cartilage is bigger and thicker. So your voice resonates a little deeper than the average female. All right, this cartilage right underneath it, there's the thyroid. This is cricoid right there. It looks like a class ring. There's like the band of the ring and the other part, but it's kind of reversed. The band of the ring is anterior and the rest of the ring is posterior. That's the cricoid cartilage. Means ring shape. Two big ones. And if you look at other pictures or other aspects of the larynx, here's that posterior view and a superior view side by side. If you look at the superior view, you see inside of the voice box you have your two vocal ligaments. They attach to the inside of the front of the thyroid. And then you run posteriorly and attach to these two cartilages that can pivot, which are called the arytenoid cartilages. So that when I note those. paired arytenoid cartilages. So what I said was vocal ligaments. Vocal ligaments attached to arytenoid cartilages and thyroid cartilage. I'm going to get one of our functional lenses, it's over there. I want to hold the model in the same perspective as that first superior view. So this is the model, and that's that, with my dad. It's called functional because you can pull on this. You can see how it moves the vocal cords, okay? And you can see how the arytenoids pivot. Here you see the epiglottic cartilage. I just call it the epiglottis. This guards the airway during swallowing. Guards airway during swallowing. Also, at the tip of the arytenoid cartilage is a little horn called the corniculate cartilage. So note those, the paired corniculate cartilages. Paracuniculate cartilages on top of arytenoid cartilages. Now, there's another cartilage called cuneiform cartilage, and it's not shown here, but you can see it in other pictures. Let me write it down. Cuneiform. Basically, these two cartilages, the corniculate and the cuneiform cartilages, they appear as tubercles, little bumps. Get the rest of my pens. So, this one. Look for them as tubercles. Let me write those terms on the board. Corniculate, cuneiform, tubercles. You can see those structures on models where they put the mucous membrane. They kind of drape it over the laryngeal cartilages. So let me go back to a view and you can see it. You can see it here. with this one here. Okay. On this model, number 4 is the arytenoid cartilage. Number 5 is the paniculate cartilage. But you see when you put the skin over it, it looks like a little bump. So that bump, call it the corniculate tubercle. This bump is the cuneiform tubercle. Okay, so you're expected to know those two bumps. Once again, to look at it on this picture. Oops. Flip it on there. The corniculate and the cuneiform tubercles. Okay, so don't let bumps slip by you here, and when you put the skin over it, that's epiglottis, which will cover the airway during swallowing, and that's one of its functions, to protect the airway. So we're at this picture. Let's look at this picture. This picture shows both ligaments, not just the vocal ligament. I put this side by side because the lips are the ligaments here. When you study Mr. Halfhead, these lips are your true and false vocal cords, or vocal ligaments. The one on the bottom is the vocal ligament, the one on the top is the vestibular ligament. And those ligaments with the mucous membrane on are those structures there. So, you have to know those. Know the vestibular ligament and the vocal ligament. The space between them is the glottis. You can't really see that here. Now this ligament, the vestibular ligament, does not function in voice production. Okay, so it's also called the false vocal cord for that reason. Now when you put the skin over it, some people call that the vestibular fold with the ligament inside. All of these are acceptable terms, interchangeable, to refer to that top ligament. Vestibular ligaments, the false vocal cord, or vestibular fold, okay, if there's skin over it. Now, the bottom one, the vocal ligament, actually produces the sound of your voice. So that is the vocal ligament, or true vocal cord. And if you put the mucous membrane over it, you can call it the vocal fold, or true vocal fold, or whatever. Let's just call it vocal fold. So again, here the vocal fold and the vestibular fold. Okay, that's what it looks like there. We'll go back to this slide, and then we'll move on to this slide. This is a picture of corniculate cartilage on top of the arytenoid cartilage, right? Here, just the little horn part is corniculate. But this pitcher-shaped cartilage is the arytenoid cartilage. That's a word that means pitcher shape. It's pouring a glass of iced tea or something. I think what you should know about them is it's attached to the vocal cord. And like I said before, they pivot. The space between vocal cords is the glottis. Okay, this is what it looks like in a laryngoscope. Like I said earlier, if you ever get the experience to learn how to intubate, this is what you're looking for. I'm trying to see these whitish vocal cords, because that's where you're going to put the air tube. Space between the vocal cords is the glottis. That's how you get to the airway, okay, through the glottis, that space. The glottis, again, is covered by the epiglottis, right? Epi means on top of. The epiglottis literally covers the glottis during swallowing. So when you take a breath in, inhale, the vocal cords open. I put these three side by side. I just took a picture of the model, looking down it, to try to match the view of a laryngoscope. I'm just looking for those whitish vocal cords. The space is the epiglottis, it's right down there. You put your eyeball here, look right down there, and you get that view of the glottis slash vocal cords. So here's the figure of the book with vocal, with glottis open and closed, basically. Vocal folds in an open position or a closed position. So on our model, you know, there's this picture. You can take the model apart and you can see both folds, the vestibular fold and the vocal fold. The vestibular fold is kind of creating a shelf over the vocal cord that kind of help guard the airway. Okay, it's like if something small gets there, maybe it falls on the shelf, you can cough it out. Now when you talk, it's the intermittent release of exhaled air. So here you see the opening and closing of the glottis. The opening is the top picture. When you talk, it closes. When you open, upon inhalation, vocal cords open, air rushes in. And then upon exhalation, vocal cords close, air is forced to whistle through a slit, vibrating the vocal cords, producing sound. Okay. So if you never thought about it, every time you talk, it's always a breath out. Okay. I mean, try talking while breathing in. You talk like that. Then you can't do it, right? I've tried many times. Every time I give this lecture, I always try. Sound ridiculous. So, just a little bit, I mean, I'm not gonna lecture on phonation very much, but since we're talking about vocal cords, the pitch is determined by the length and tension of the vocal cords. The loudness depends upon the force at which air rushes across them. When the pharynx, nasal cavities resonate and amplify sound, sound is shaped into language by the action of the pharynx, tongue, soft palate, and lips. My voice is a little hoarse. I had some post-nasal drip from allergies yesterday. I'm expecting the sound of my voice. A couple of muscles, okay, not too many. I'll just give you two to know that control the larynx, that can control the pitch and tension of the vocal cords. One on the front, one on the back. The one on the front I want you to know is called, well, it's got a couple of heads. It's called cricothyroid. Thyroid. Okay. There's your muscles, one on the front, thyroid. There's different reasons for giving the muscles their names. This one, as you can probably tell, is named for the cartilages it attaches to. And it's always origin insertion, right? Origin insertion. So this cartilage will pivot forward, tensing the vocal cords inside. The one on the back is the posterior cricoarytenoid. Action of the cricothyroid is to tense vocal cords, affecting the pitch. The action of the posterior cricoarytenoid, I put that one there, it's pretty important. It abducts the vocal cords. If that muscle is paralyzed for any reason, you might have trouble breathing. It abducts vocal cords. Abduction. Abducts. Here's a picture showing the branches of the laryngeal nerve. I want you to know the innervation to these muscles. And the anatomy is a little different. We have the aortic arch and one branch on the right side basically goes under the back. It's recurrent, okay? Goes under, comes back. It's the brachial trunk. On the left side, the branch of the recurrent laryngeal nerve goes underneath the aortic arch. Okay, it goes this way. So the branch I want you to know is called the superior laryngeal nerve. Basically, they all are derived from the vagus nerve. Okay. So hypothyroid innervated by superior. Laryngeal nerve. Now this picture is important. One of the symptoms of an aortic aneurysm is you have a hoarse voice. So how would that affect a hoarse voice? Now you know. You can see the nerve goes under the artery. If the aneurysm is bulging right there and it affects the nerve, it might affect your voice. So if you remember that, and you ever encountered that, it might save someone's life. All right, so here's the tension of the vocal cords. There's a little screw there they put in the model. I mean, and when you can like move it, kind of pivots a little bit. And you can imagine the vocal cords inside becoming more tense, increasing the pitch of your voice. There's a picture of me just kind of pulling a little bit. I kind of did it for you. You can see the abduction of the vocal cords there. It's just kind of good to see. You're mimicking the action of the posterior cricoarytenoid muscle. Now that nerve, posterior cricoarytenoid, is innervated by the inferior laryngeal nerve. Action and innovation. So there's the abduction of the vocal cords. This model that I showed you before does show both nerves, which is why it made it on your study guide. Superior and inferior laryngeal nerves innervating those two muscles. Something else related to physiology involving the glottis is called the Valsalva's maneuver, which is to strain against a closed glottis, that kind of grunting that you do, like when you lift a heavy object or something. You do it when you empty your rectum, right? Lift heavy objects, you just didn't know you're doing it. It's called Valsalva's maneuver. Strain against a closed glottis. So what happens is, when you do that, you kind of make the trunk, the torso, into a splint, because you're trapping the air in the respiratory system. And it helps increase abdominal pressure, too, to help empty the rectum. So air is held temporarily in the lower respiratory tract. It causes intra-abdominal pressure to rise when the abdominal muscles contract and helps empty the rectum. So basically, it acts as a splint to stabilize the trunk, like say if you're lifting a heavy box or something. And it also increases blood flow to the head. I kind of do Valsalva's maneuver for falling asleep on the commute home. It also can be used to equalize middle air pressure, like make your ears pop a little bit when you're driving up to Lake Tahoe or something like that. So that takes us to the trachea. So you go larynx, now trachea, which is just inferior to it. As you can see here, the trachea ends when it bifurcates into the primary bronchi right behind the sternal angle. Okay, that's kind of where we are in the chest there. It's your one airway. The trachea is your airway before it divides. Because it's going to divide into the lungs and divide many, many times. It's the main airway. It's about 2.5 centimeters in diameter. That's big enough to maybe accommodate, you know, a normal sized finger. Here, what we see is, the shape of it in cross section. It's kind of this U-shaped trachea. Now that's one important structure. These tracheal cartilage rings help keep the airway patent. Tracheal rings are cartilaginous. They're stiff. That's good. It keeps the airway open as you ventilate air through it. It won't collapse. Stiff. Keeps airway open, or sometimes people say patent. Patent means open. Notice that posterior to it is soft tissue, which is the muscle and the ligament there. That's so because when you swallow food, that big bolus of food that you swallow, soft tissue can accommodate better when you swallow food. Okay. So the esophagus is posterior to the trachea. And there's three layers to the tracheal wall. The main job is to conduct air. In this lecture, you try to keep in your head, there's the conducting airways, and then there's the respiratory zone, where we can have gas exchange. This is the main conducting airway. Okay, look how thick that wall is. There's gonna be no gas exchange across a wall that thick. And what I want students to know are the three layers, the mucosa, submucosa, and the adventitia. We'll write it out here, but that top layer is the epithelium, so that's the mucosa. From here to here, call it submucosa, full of glands that keep the airway moist, a big thick mucus layer. From here to here is adventitia. This is a cut cartilage ring. This is hyaline cartilage. Okay, so let's take a look at a medium magnification IMAG. This is the mucosa from here to here. And trachea wall consists of mucosa. And what we see from this picture is it's a ciliated pseudostratified columnar epithelial tissue with goblet cells. Ciliated. Pseudostratified columnar. I'll say ET for epithelial tissue with the goblet cells. And underlying it, there is an epithelium. I'm sorry, underlying the epithelium, there's a lamina propria, a thin layer of connective tissue. That's called the lamina propria. Lamina propria underlies the epithelium. Now, I would say the function of this is to make it a good mucous membrane. You want a nice thick layer of mucus inside your airway to help trap debris and particulates. So goblet cells can help do that. But more so, in the submucosa, you have seromucous glands. All these cuboidal tissues are glands. Okay. So submucosa. Has seromucous glands. Each one of those glands is dumping its mucus secretion onto the surface along with the goblet cells. And we have one slide in our collection I found. They kind of cut that gland in the exact place so you can actually see the duct leading to the surface. Usually you don't see that. You just cut it in a place where you don't have the duct. This was in a perfect view, so we can kind of see how it terminates at the surface. So here's a seromucous gland of the submucosa. Here. This one is a gland next to it. It's kind of like, this view is like you're inside here, and you're looking around, and you're looking at the top of the epithelium. It's pretty cool. I just kind of like that one. Yeah, there's a closer view of it. Anyways, the function of all the mucus I keep talking about, it's a mucus escalator function. It traps it and moves it one way, up and out. The mucus is good for that. All the dense cilia helps provide the function of mucus escalator. Cilia, mucus, provide a mucus escalator function. Helps trap debris and helps you have a productive cough. When you cough things, you get it out, just like that. But when, if you smoke, smoker's cough is you're obliterating this mucus escalator function. You kill the cilia, you kill the epithelia, and so you lose that. So smoker's cough is not as productive because you've lost this function. Of course, if you're able to quit smoking, you can get it back because epithelial tissue in general is highly regenerative. So you'll restore the cilia and the mucus and get it all back. All right, so one last thing before I leave the trachea down here. That is this wall here. The only thing I want you to know in the adventitia is the hyaline cartilage of the tracheal rings. Know that it's hyaline cartilage, and know that the shape of the trachea, the tracheal rings, is C-shaped, or in this case, like a horseshoe. It's not a circle. It's not a true ring. So adventitia. Know the tracheal rings. There's other things there, but most prominently there is the tracheal rings. They're U-shaped. They're made out of hyaline cartilage. Again, I said their function, keep the airway open. I already said that. And as we proceed through the airways, the airways will get smaller and smaller, and the cartilage will decrease less and less and less. Eventually, you want to thin out this big, thick wall to a simple squamous epithelial tissue in the alveolar space, but we're not there yet. So we'll go to the next slide after the mucus escalator and talk about the bronchial tree. I want you to know how the how the airways divide in the lungs. And the trachea is before the airway divides because it's one tube and it hasn't divided yet. I show you an image like that, and I say, identify like the layer. What would you say? Submucosa will be correct. What's this layer? Adventitia. What if I had you just identify this? Starts with an L. LP. Lamina propria, yeah. And this epithelium, I'll have you identify that, I'm sure. It's a mouthful, right? It's ciliated. It looks like it's stratified. Look at all these nuclei stacked on top of one another. But it's not. It's one layer of cells. It just appears stratified. So it's pseudostratified, columnar, ET, you can use ET, with goblet cells. So they're there. Okay. What if I just say identify structure?
It's the sebaceous gland.
Yeah, it's a gland, not sebaceous, mucus. You could say mucus or seromucus. And sometimes I spell mucus just US, or sometimes it's OUS, but both spellings are acceptable. Okay. What if I said identify tissue? What would you put? Hyaline cartilage. If I say identify like the layer, it's like part of the adventitia. Right, so that's the trachea. One airway, and it's going to divide 23, 24 times, depending on which book you read. Let's talk about the bronchial tree and the conducting airways. The carina is the last tracheal cartilage, and it marks the end of the trachea when it branches into the right and left bronchi. When air reaching the bronchi, it's warm and cleansed of its impurities and saturated with water vapor and, oops, the bronchi subdivide into secondary bronchi, each supplying lobes and lungs. So I kind of want to like outline like all the airways, showing you this picture here. This is showing you like the bronchial tree along with trachea and larynx. There's your voice box there. And you can talk about the different airways by the division. This slide starts with the first division. Well, let's start before the first division at zero. Division zero. Before it divides, you have the trachea with cartilage rings. The trachea has proportionally the most cartilage out of all the airways. Okay, it's you got one of them, it's like 2.5 centimeters in diameter, about, give or take, a few millimeters. When you get to the last tracheal ring, that's called the carina. It looks like the underpants. We call it the underpants. Kind of looks like it. And we call it the bronchial tree, but it's really an upside down tree, right? The trunk would be the trachea, kind of reverse it and look like a tree. No, the carina. The last ring before the first division. say before the tracheal bifurcation. That's what it says on the slide. So when it divides, you have the right and left primary bronchi. So that's the first division. So now, instead of one airway, you're going to have two airways. We call it your primary bronchi, because they're the two airways of the first division. And those two airways are the left main bronchus, the right main bronchus. Those are the names. If you don't prefer primary bronchi, you could say right main bronchus or left main bronchus. Each airway is conducting fresh air to each lung, right and left lung. Each conduct air to right, left lungs. Now the airways are much like the trachea. Right and left main bronchus, they're very similar in structure. They don't change much. The airways are starting to decrease in size, but not by much at this point. Now when it divides again, when each of those two airways divides, we call that the second division. And that gives way to five secondary or lobar bronchi. For division number two, gives you five airways. And these are called, we can call them secondary bronchi or lobar bronchi. So you have five secondary bronchi, or you can use the term lobar, five lobar bronchi, because each of those five airways is conducting fresh air to a lobe of a lung. Each conduct air to a lobe of a lung. So you have two lobes on the left lung and three lobes on the right lung, accounting for all five airways, right? So just remember, two left, three right. So on the picture here, here's the left main bronchus, here's the right main bronchus, and it's gonna divide. One remark about the right and the left, they're not completely the same, are they, right and left? Notice the left, remember, it has the aortic arch going over it, so it kind of like makes it more horizontal. The right main bronchus is kind of more vertical with the trachea. And so clinically what they say is, say a small child swallows a whole peanut, and it goes down the airway. And it's more likely to get trapped on the right main bronchus because it's more in line with the trachea than the left because of how the aortic arch swings over. That's one difference I might note. More in line with trachea. Go back just a little bit. Okay, so those five airways. Let me see if the app can show us the lobar bronchi a little better. could just do this. I want to highlight the bronchial tree. I want to hide others. So we're just looking at starting from the first division. That will be the left main bronchus, highlighted in green. So you can see kind of where it ends. And then that would be, they call it the inferior lobar bronchus. You don't have to know inferior, just know that in that division, they're lobar bronchi or secondary bronchi. So there's another lobar bronchus, and there's another lobar bronchus. That's the left side, those two. On the right side, here's the right main bronchus, okay? That's the first division. The lobar bronchi are that one there, and that's a lobar bronchus. It's a middle lobar, and that's an inferior lobar. There are three lobes on the right side, superior, middle, inferior lobes. On the left side, there is just two, superior, inferior. Okay. So what comes after secondary? Tertiary. I'm gonna go back to the top of the board here. So we're on the third division. There's gonna be 23 or 24 total divisions, so we're on three. So in the third division, there's going to be something like 19 or 20 airways. And they're still called bronchi, so you can call them tertiary bronchi or segmental bronchi. Those are the terms that are used. Notice that when you're getting to the tertiary, let me highlight one, the next branch basically. That's middle lobar. That's a segmental bronchus. Look at how the cartilage has decreased. This is all cartilage, and as you branch, you're losing cartilage. This tertiary bronchus has some cartilage, but the proportion is decreasing quite a bit. That's one thing to know. So I'm just writing proportionally less cartilage. It kind of decreases with each division there. So just know that each of these 19 or 20 airways is delivering fresh air to a segment of a lobe. Remember, fresh air to a segment of a lobe. Hence the term segmental bronchi. So primary, secondary, tertiary. After that, it kind of gets, the airways get too small and too numerous. But we'll keep going. Let me go back to the slides. Two airways. So therefore, those are the primary bronchi, my two red arrows. Here's the underwear, right? Korea, the last ring. Anyways, I got five arrows. Five lobar bronchi, the second division. Now the third division, the 19 segmental bronchi, lung lobes are divided into bronchopulmonary segments. So each of those tertiary bronchi are delivering fresh air to a segment of a lobe, shown here, known as bronchopulmonary segments. I should note that. Know the bronchopulmonary segments. segment includes the airway with the lung tissue, right? The segment of the lobe. So you get the airway in there, the one of the 19 or 20 tertiary airways with the lung tissue. In this picture, it's color-coded, so you know which one. They're listed with Roman numerals. You don't have to know those, just know the concept of a bronchopulmonary segment. But also, you know, the artery, it follows the airway. And so I've heard it's useful for surgeons if they have to remove parts of your lung. They just remove the whole segment because you get the blood with the airway with the lung tissue. Nice little package. Artery follows airway. All right, so we're going to keep going with the divisions here. We're only on division 3. There's 23 or 24 orders of division there. This picture of the book is useful. Remember, the airway is a dead end. There's the end. So just to kind of speed it up here, 3 go all the way down to like 10, okay? With each division now, the airways are increasing and increasing and increasing. And the airways are still called bronchi, but they're called subsegmental bronchi. And when you get down to 10, you've got too many to count. There's something like 10,000 airways when you get to the 10th division. And they're super small. They're like maybe a millimeter in diameter. Okay. That's a lot of airways. That's good. That's what you need. Okay, so you go from 10 to 11 or 12, depending on which book you read, but I'll just say 11. You go from bronchi to bronchiole, the smallest airway that has no cartilage. So that's kind of like you start to have bronchioles on 2. So this is kind of where the bronchioles start on this figure there. So go from 10 to 11, bronchioles, no cartilage. What you're doing is you're starting to increase the proportion of smooth muscle. Okay, you've been decreasing cartilage, increasing smooth muscle. I'll put ANS here because ANS, the autonomics, control the system at this level because you can modify the smooth muscle. Controls there. So we call it bronchoconstriction or dilation. Bronchoconstrict or bronchodilate. Yeah, question.
What's that again?
ANS stands for autonomic nervous system. And that hasn't been said. What do you think the function is of the sympathetic response? Which one? Dilating. That will help increase the airways. I know constrict is intuitive because we taught you that sympathetics constrict the blood supply, right, for the arterioles, but airways is reverse. The smooth muscles will contract in a way to open the airway to decrease resistance to airflow. Okay. Right, let's continue on. I'm going to continue on to the top of the board here. So bronchioles, you have bronchioles 11, 12, 13, 14, like 15, 16. Just clear this out. Okay, so imagine we get all the way to the 16th division. That's called the terminal bronchioles, and they're right here, number 5. The terminal bronchioles are the end of the conducting airways.
Okay.
The end of the conducting airways. What that means is, at the next division, excuse me, you'll start to see alveoli studying the bronchioles so you can have gas exchange. So after this begins the respiratory zone. So I'll just draw a line. So after this, now we get the main function, gas exchange possible. Gas exchange possible. Alveoli present. So on the figure, the respiratory zone is that bottom figure there. Let me show you the figure, which is a close-up of that. I want you to know that in the lab, we have this on a model, so it's useful to look at in the classroom as well as just not in your book. But here's a picture of the respiratory zone bronchial tree. So basically from 17, 18, 19, those divisions shown here, you have respiratory bronchioles, basically bronchioles with alveoli. The next three divisions, like which would be in here, you can't really see what's going on in there. But you have these structures called alveolar ducts. 20, 21, 22. Now I haven't been mentioning it, but by the time you get all the way down to here, we're almost at the end, you have something like 80 million airways. And maybe they're about a half millimeter in diameter. Okay, so then you really shrunk them and there's like a lot of them. So when we get to the last one, just the end, alveolus, 23. Some books say it's the 24th division. It's okay. Either one's fine. Point is there's a lot. When you get to the 23rd division, we have something like 600 million. And that's a lot of gas exchange occurring there. Maybe the 0.3 millimeters in diameter. There's a small little microscopic air sacs for lots of gas exchange. So let's start to look at the picture here. The respiratory bronchioles, you can see there's a lot of smooth muscle there. That tissue is smooth muscle, but then there's also a lot of elastic fibers there. I don't know if you can see it. Let me zoom in a little bit. They're illustrating elastic tissue, like little purple bands surrounding the alveolar sacs. And I would note that. Lots of elastic tissue. At around this level, at the last level, increasing amounts of elastic tissue. The elastic recoil of the lung is very important for the mechanics of breathing, which I'll talk about later today. Also, they call structure number 7 asinus. I didn't put it in my list there, but basically they're just describing the shape of this structure there. I think of it as several clusters of grapes, okay, this asinus. Number 8, alveolar sac, is one cluster of grapes. One grape would be alveolus, okay? So be able to distinguish asinus versus alveolar sac versus alveolus. An alveolar duct is shown here, number 9, and it leads into many alveoli. So alveolar duct leads into many alveolar sacs, little tiny alveoli. Let's look at the pulmonary circulation with this structure. Notice that the pulmonary artery is on the airway here, carrying deoxygenated blood. It branches out into the pulmonary capillaries, where you have the gas exchange, where the blood will be infused with oxygen. You'll pick up O2. And the pulmonary veins are kind of off the airway in these in the fibrous septum between lobules. And those will all drain to the four pulmonary veins eventually. Okay. So, excuse me. The thing to note is the pulmonary artery is on the airway. The pulmonary vein is off the airway. Basically off it. We have some models of showing you this structure with the pulmonary circulation. Here's a model we have on the shelf in the back of the room. This also adds the bronchial artery. The bronchial artery is not part of pulmonary circulation. Okay, it's just supplying oxygen-rich blood to the lungs. Pulmonary circulation is shown here and here. Pulmonary artery, bronchial artery, pulmonary vein. You can see all the alveolar sacs here. To show you one cut open. So that little circle will be an alveolar duct leading to these different alveoli. Okay, there's the pulmonary capillary shown there. This model shows quite a bit. Okay, on this model, that picture I showed you earlier, it's kind of hiding there. So I just want you to know where that picture came from. All right, so let's talk about the respiratory membrane. I circle this, but this is what we just did. We went through all the divisions of the airway, okay? And the cross-sectional area for the respiratory membrane is a lot. It's over a million. So I want to teach you the anatomy of the respiratory membrane shown here in this close-up little inset. So remember, the main function I'm supposed to teach you is gas exchange. This is where it happens. At this level, pretty much anywhere we have an alveolus, you have gas exchange. You see here, you know, the main cell of the alveolar wall, I would describe it as a simple squamous epithelium. The main cell of the wall, they call it type 1. Alveolar wall cell, basically. Get some more colors. one, alveolar. So it's a simple squamous epithelial cell. I'll just put ET cell, simple squamous cell. It's the main cell of the cell wall. So on the other side of that is the fresh air that you're breathing. Okay, so it's kind of fused to an endothelial cell of the capillary endothelium. Endothelial cell of pulmonary capillary. And these two cells of the air sac and the capillary are fused with the basement membrane. So the green is fused basement membrane. There are other cell types. If there's type 1, it stands to reason there's got to be at least a type 2. The second type is right here, shown in green. That is a type 2. They secrete surfactants. Surfactants break the water surface tension, and it basically makes it easier to breathe. So, type 2 cells secrete surfactants. Don't confuse type 2 and type 1. Remember, type 1, it's a squamous cell. What does squamous mean? Flat. That's a flatter cell. Type 2 is more round, and there's fewer of them. There's also resident macrophages shown. On the picture there, this purplish-bluish color, keeping things sterile. So I'll just put resident macrophage. But this is the dead end. This is, you get gas exchange and the function is complete. What they show you is the wall is not sealed. You have little pores. So air can get in, of course.
Is that resident macrophage?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, wait, that meter, sorry. Resident macrophage. Here's a picture of the back of the model, so you can study the alveolar wall. I might have you identify the capillaries, the pulmonary capillaries, the macrophages, the star-like clusters. They show you type 1 and type 2 right there. Zoom in, but you can't see in the back. I don't want to trick you, so let me tell you what they're trying to show you. Could you tell type 1 from type 2 out of these two? What's that one?
Simple. Type 1.
Yeah, it's the one, type 1, because it's flatter than this one. So just look for the more flatter one to be type 1, call this one a surfactant cell or type 2. Here's a real histology slide. It's a LOMAG. This is normal lung. There's no pathology here. You can see at the level of bronchial on down. So whenever you see a little thickened membrane there, that's going to be some kind of bronchial. Okay. This leading to that is a bronchial leading to an alveolar duct. Okay. Whenever you get these little hallways, it's like alveolar duct, like this one here. There's a duct leading to a couple of ducts, right? Imagine like you have a big, long hallway, which represents alveolar duct. And along the hallway, there's these sliding doors. And you open all the doors, which lead into rooms. That's kind of like what this is here. alveolar ducts leading into alveoli, these little chambers there. So, again, there's a bronchial right there. This is a low mag. Let's go to higher. This is a medium mag indication. So if I just went like this, I said identify, what would you put?
Alveolar duct.
Alveolar duct. Now, a sac looks more like this, with many alveoli at the outskirts there. But more of a hallway shape is a duct. What if I just point to like something like that? Alveolus. Just one tiny grape. Here's a close-up of the bronchial. Remember when we studied the different three layers of the tracheal wall, mucosa, submucosa, adventitia? This is what a bronchial looks like. I just see an epithelium and several layers of smooth muscle cells. There's no cartilage, just smooth muscle. Okay, so that's the bronchial wall. And I kind of put the bronchial wall next to the tracheal wall. This is the whole bronchial wall. This is just the mucosa of the trachea. And I want you to see side by side the epithelium, how it's thinned out. Here it was before the airway divided. Okay. Now it looks, it changes quite a bit. It's got to get all the way down to this type of epithelium here, which is one layer, you know, it's simple squamous ET. So if we go back from micro, step out to macro, just look at the lungs as a whole, open up the chest, remove them from the chest, this is what you see, okay? Basically, the lungs are not much to look at, but you should know the lobes of the lung. And you should be able to tell right from left. From the chest cavity, but basically the apex of the lung, as you breathe in, the apex of the lung rises about 2 inches above your clavicle, so it actually gets into the base of your neck. That's how high up they go. The right lung has 3 lobes, the left lung has 2. That's one way you can tell, right from left. Three lobes, and they would be superior, middle, inferior. It's only 2 lobes. That would be superior, inferior. There are fissures that separate the lobes. On the right side, there's a horizontal fissure separating superior middle lobes, and then there's an oblique fissure separating the other two, middle from inferior. So note the 2 fissures on the right lung, horizontal, oblique. Know those. Horizontal, oblique fissures. And on the left, you have one oblique fissure separating the 2 lobes. Call this the lateral view or the costal view, because this is the side of the lung that touches the ribs on the outside. If you look at the medial aspect of the lungs, you should know the hilum of the lung. And you can even see, turn lights, you can see more detail, the cardiac impression, right? You can see where the heart would be right here, and you can see the aorta going down there. Anyways, in the hilum here and in here, you should be able to identify the pulmonary artery and vein and the airway. There's the airway, pulmonary artery above, and then pulmonary veins there. They're all in there, and they're here too. Okay, so let me note that. in the heel. One thing to note on the right is that the pulmonary artery is anterior to the airway. But on the other side, the pulmonary artery is superior to the airway. That's always true. You write that down. Pulmonary artery. Anterior to airway. Whereas in the helium on the left, pulmonary artery superior to airway. Let me show you on the app, let's make it a little more clear. Throwing in arteries, I guess. Gonna hide the heart. Here we can kind of see it. Zoom in. See the blue tube? That's the pulmonary artery. You see how it's in front of the airway? And on the other side, remember how the on the other side, the aorta has to go over the airway. I think it kind of pushes it down a little bit. So when it goes over and pulls it down, you have the artery over the airway. Okay, that's another difference between right and left. Let's take a break. Come back, I'm continuing on. But let's take about a 20-minute break, and I'm gonna finish these slides.